whoever eats it will become prey to its own predator. And that is how the coffee plant defends itself or its next generation species. Now we take this seed, bean, extract its caffeine, concentrate it, and give it to our people in the form of coffee and strongly brewed coffee and one cup of Starbucks coffee contains 180 milligrams of this poisonous material. And as you can see in the society, Starbucks coffee shops are mushrooming all over the place. And you can see 10 years from now how stupid we will become by following this fashion of sitting at the counter of Starbucks or any coffee shop. I'm not zeroing on Starbucks, but they make the strongest coffee, so they claim anyway. So this is a problem in our society that people don't realize. Caffeine is a stupefying element. It is designed to do that. Now we give this caffeine to our children. Rate of consumption of caffeine-containing beverages has shot up. It is now 64 gallons per person per year. And children as young as 1.5 to 2 years are given sodas. Older people in hospitals, instead of water, are given sodas. So you can imagine how our society is suffering because we don't understand the difference between fluids and water. Now, on top of caffeine, we are now producing diet sodas, which contain this substance called aspartame as artificial sweetener, with the false assumption that anything that doesn't have energy and is sweet is okay, because the body is only storing energy that it gets in the form of sugar when we drink these beverages. Well, the false assumption is that we are not fooling the body, we are fooling our pockets and our health and our understanding of the human body. Because the human brain is a magnificent computer. It calculates and computes the intensity of sweetness. And to the nearest energy unit, it calculates the extent of energy that is arrived by the sweetness of the element that you've swallowed. And it's been shown that up to 90 minutes after taking artificial sweetener, when the sugar or the energy that was promised is nowhere to be found, there is a panic in the body, physiological panic by the brain and the liver, and the person is compelled to go and eat and make good the promise of energy that was given to the body by the sweetness or the intensity of the sweetness. It's been shown that people go and eat heavily after taking artificial sweetener. So all these people who carry this can of soda with them in order to not put on weight, they're actually doing the reverse. They are adding weight to their body. Maybe that can of soda didn't have the sugar, but the food that they will eat within 90 minutes will have ample supply of fat-making elements in it. Artificial sweetener, aspartame, divides into aspartate, which is a directly a neuroactive amino acid. It doesn't have to be converted to any other element. Tryptophan has to be converted to serotonin and the other elements. Tyrosine has to be converted to adrenaline, noradrenaline. But aspartate doesn't have to be converted to anything. It's directly active on the reproductive centers of the brain. So we become vulnerable as a result of taking this active element by giving false starts to the reproductive system in the body. Aspartame has been recognized to give seizures. I presume it is the impact of aspartate amino acid directly on the brain in the gut. Aspartame divides into aspartate and phenylalanine, but 10% of the byproduct of metabolism in the gut is methyl alcohol and formaldehyde. So the more people drink artificial sweeteners, the more they are vulnerable to the toxicity of formaldehyde and methyl alcohol. And it has been now recognized that this element is responsible for a lot of retinal damage and visual impairment. So artificial sweetener is directly involved in eye problems. And the next one is that a lot of people who take this material become oversensitive to sense of smell. These are only highlights of the impact of this artificial sweetener. Unfortunately, this element is used in over 5,000 recipes, and we are causing a hell of a lot of damage to our body by taking this artificial sweetener. As a result of these false assumptions, we have created modern voodoo medicine of the 20th century. We use biohazardous chemicals to treat dehydration of the human body. No wonder that recently there were articles, you've all seen them, that these prescription medications, even though if taken according to the instructions of the physician, make more than 2 million people sicker and kill a few hundred thousand people every year. That is according to prescription, not how many mistakes are made in using prescription medication. We've produced a cost-intensive and cost-escalating sick care system because the system can only survive and thrive if people are sick. If they're well, if they're healthy, there is no sick care system, it'll be a health care system. Prevention will become a part of the program, not treatment. I can assure you that if we change the paradigm and I understand dehydration as the origin of pain and disease, we can reduce the health care cost of this society by no less than 60% in a matter of 10, 15 years. And have a much healthier nation, clearer thinking, more elevated in our thoughts and behavior. This is my understanding, and that's what I'm mostly talking, and my writing is addressing this issue. And I've just come back from another book tour where I traveled 14 cities. I went before television and radio and talked my head off, but no one would listen, so. Now, let us see what are the physiological effects of water in the body. Water has two main effects in the body. It has a life-giving effect. In other words, it doesn't perpetuate life, but it gives life. So water is vital for creation of life. Water manufactures hydroelectricity. When it rushes through the cell membrane, it turns cation pumps. It's the element that turns the pumps and does molecular exchange at the cell membrane. Water is behind that. It manufactures the energy for that function. It manufactures energy for neurotransmission through the nerve pathways. It's a process of hydrolysis is an energizing element, an energizing effect. The food that you eat has absolutely no energy value whatsoever unless there is water there to break it down, hydrolyze it, and energize it to be absorbed. I will show you a slide of that later. Then water is the bonding material. It's adhesive that binds the elements together and maintains the integrity of the cell membrane so that whatever goes inside the cell and whatever is going outside of the cell, it doesn't interfere with the functions of the cell. And things will not spill out of the cell unnecessarily because there is an integrated cell membrane. Water is responsible for that. Now, this is research done by Philippa M. Wiggin. The source of energy for cation transport or ATP synthesis, this is energy manufacturing mechanism, lies in increase in chemical potentials with increasing hydration of small cations and polyphosphate anions in the highly structured interfacial aqueous phase of the two phosphorylated intermediates. In other words, water is responsible for bringing about ATP synthesis. Water is the source of energy. Good, I'm glad. Who knew that? Who was it that knew that? Raise your hand. Okay. Now, also, water produces high heat of activation at the cell membrane. This is a very important information. Heat is a source of energy. We all know that, okay? The body has learned to use this heat generated by water when it rushes through the cell membrane and trap and bind calcium molecules together. As you know, when you heat water, the calcium in the water furs on the side of the kettle. This is the property of calcium. When it sees heat, it immediately grabs its brother, another calcium molecule, and they hug each other. They unite and they bind. The body uses that heat in order to bind calcium atoms together. Because later on, the body also knows how to separate these brothers, calcium molecules, apart and release the ATP energy that is stored in the calcium bondage. So with this information, you all know now that your bones are primary reservoirs of energy. Dehydration will unlock this energy and release the calcium, and gradually the bone will begin to lose density. That's how osteoporosis begins. Okay?